studied the high walls surrounding the sun-drenched compound and the low buildings inside. Looks like a private park, Sharky said. Looks like a canine training center to me, Xander said. Looks like easy fishing in the pond, Peppy said. Looks like Dame Esmeralda can freely move around the compound, Simon said. You've met her and can identify her from this distance? Xander asked. Simon nodded. Does she seem the same? She isn't wearing her pearls. You can tell from this distance? Xander wasn't even close enough to be positive of her markings, so either Simon had amazing eyesight or he knew Dame Esmeralda extremely well, or he was merely claiming that the light-colored Norwegian forest cat was Dame Esmeralda. And if that was the case, why? She's a friend of the family. What exactly do you mean by that? Sharky demanded. Xander wanted to know the answer to that, too, and suspected it might explain why Simon notified Lady Montgomery directly, instead of putting the information through the normal channels. Simon wrapped his fluffy tail around his toes, like a shield, then muttered, "She's my godmother." Xander blinked. Sharky's mouth dropped open. Peppy asked, "Is it my imagination or does it look like the dogs are obeying her?" All three cats turned their attention back to the distant compound, where Dame Esmeralda did seem to be overseeing the training of the dogs. Xander scratched his ear and cued his collar's volume receptor. Though the voice was faint, he could distinguish the words, "Perfect Popo. I am very proud of you." She seemed to be speaking to a brown puppy, who was rolling in the grass with excitement. When it was finished rolling, it hopped up, crawled to her and appeared to kiss her toes. Xander clicked off the feature, stared at Simon and asked, "Exactly how long she has been affiliating with dogs? Aside from Duke and Duchess." Simon shrugged. "And they are? Members of her family." Xander stared at Simon, wondering how much other crucial information he had withheld. "Explain exactly why you contacted," Simon quickly said. "Fine, but not here or now." "Why not?" Simon glared at him. Xander's claws itched to smack the smug kid. "Because of you, I have spent days trying to sort this mess out instead of finish the emergency preparedness project I was working on." Xander looked at Sharky and Peppy. "I'm sure all of us, including your bird friend, had other things they could be doing, instead of go chasing around these mountains and getting eaten by bugs. Or landing in rotten fish, which he could still smell between his toes, no matter how many times he'd washed them. It was my only option. Somehow, I doubt that. No one would listen to me." Xander studied the boy through squinted eyes. "You never brought the problem to my attention before it became a crisis. Exactly what are we dealing with?" He leaned so close that their noses nearly touched and lowered his voice. "I want the truth, and if I even get a whiff of a red herring, you will regret it to your dying day." Simon stood up on trembling paws. "Fine, but not here." He took an unsteady step deeper into the underbrush. "Peppy, keep an eye on the compound and see if you can find any weak spots in their defenses." Xander looked at Sharky. "I would appreciate it if you helped him." Though her ears were nearly flat against her head, she nodded. Once they were deep in the foliage, Xander spun to face Simon. "Talk and do not leave anything out." Simon swallowed. "How well do you know her?" "Who? Sharky? Esmeralda? Both, actually. I met Sharky when we docked in this country and only know Esmeralda by pedigree." "What difference does that make?" "I'm not sure, but you might have noticed that this island has an extremely large dog population." Xander nodded as he swished his whiskers to urge Simon to continue. "Training centers are not the only thing we have a lot of. I can't prove it, but I believe there are also laboratories which conduct psychological projects. Are you suggesting that either Sharky or Esmeralda might have been brainwashed or something?" "It's possible." "Then why not me?" "No time." "Well, based on that factor, how am I supposed to know that you haven't had your thoughts twisted?" Simon's eyes widened. "We can't know, can we?" Xander studied the boy's expression and decided it would be best to calm him. "Have any of your caller's alerts been triggered?" Simon shook his head. "Then it is unlikely that your thoughts have been compromised." Xander narrowed his eyes as he studied him. "You are aware that the gems are programmed to be compatible with our individual thought patterns, correct?" "I did hear something about that." "Well, then, if your collar is fine, you probably are too." Simon licked his upper lip. "So, what does that say about Sharky and Esmeralda?" Xander perked his ears, urging him to be specific. Your little friend doesn't have a collar and Esmeralda's got broken a couple months ago. At least that's what she said, but I would have thought she would have had it repaired by now. Big problem, isn't it? Are you beginning to understand why I went into a panic and contacted Lady Montgomery as soon as I realized her sister had disappeared? I think so. However, to deal with this mess, I need facts, so can you please begin with the first time you thought or felt there could be a problem with Esmeralda? Well, that would be the first time I actually saw her, when I was 2 weeks old and my eyes were finally open, and realized that Duke, who everyone knew was her dear friend, was a poodle. If Xander hadn't already been sitting down, he would have landed, hard, on his tail. He took a deep breath, held it for the count of 10, then blew it out. Dear friend. Simon nodded. It was a big surprise. May I ask if your parents knew about Duke when they named Esmeralda your godmother? Simon nodded. I think it was mainly a political move, but they really like her, and I don't think they would have done it purely for politics. Xander silently studied Simon, before he said, makes sense. Lady Montgomery would already have been well known when you were born. He scratched a bug bite on his ear. I take it that her only oddity is having a canine for a friend? As far as I know. Simon wrapped his tail around his toes, in a defensive posture. Actually, he is a good guy and aside from his looks, he thinks and acts a lot like a cat. Years of gathering information enabled Xander to appear calm. She's not the first cat to have a dog for a friend. I, myself, know a couple honorable canines. Simon visibly relaxed. Much as we would like to believe otherwise, we cats are not the only intelligent species. A pretty yellow butterfly fluttered by. Sometimes, I wonder how many species believe that they are the superior one. Humans sure think so. Xander nodded in agreement. Perhaps, one of these centuries, our scientists will figure out a way we can control them better and stop them from killing each other over silly things. They do seem to have an inordinate interest in power and profit. But with a pitiful understanding of what is actually valuable. However, that is not a problem that you and I need to deal with today. And I need to know the actual situation, not something designed to get help, so please begin from the moment you realized something was wrong and you needed help and do not stop talking until you fully explain all you know about this country's dog situation and how it relates to the facility Esmeralda is at. Simon started talking and didn't stop for over 2 hours.